We had already seen that fixing three angles of a triangle does not guarantee congruent triangles. So I have these two triangles where these three angles are fixed. So angle A is equal to P, C is equal to R, and B is equal to Q. But are these triangles congruent? No, because there is a change in the size. Now let's just fix two angles. Would that guarantee congruency? Let's see. But wouldn't fixing two angles actually be the same as fixing three angles? Say if I fix this angle to be 50 degrees and I say that this angle is fixed to be 60 degrees, then I know that sum of angles in a triangle is 180 degrees. Let's say this is angle X. So 50 degrees plus 60 degrees plus X should be equal to 180 degrees because sum of angles in a triangle is 180. Now 50 plus 60 is 110 degrees plus X is 180 degrees. So from here I can say that X would be 180 degrees minus 110 degrees. So I get that X would be 70 degrees. So now the third angle, which is X, is also fixed. X can neither be less than 70 nor be greater than 70. It would always be 70 if I fix the other two angles. So now again, three angles we've already seen. Fixing two angles is same as fixing three angles, and fixing three angles does not guarantee congruency. So what do I do? Along with these two angles, let me fix another side and see whether this would give me congruent triangles or not. So I fix these two angles and I fix a third side. So there's two angles and one side is fixed. Now I know that I cannot rotate this side because that would change the angle. Similarly, I cannot rotate the yellow side also because that would also change the angle, whereas the angle is fixed. So what I do is I can just increase or decrease the length of these sides. This side is fixed, I cannot move this. So I increase this. Now I can increase and decrease the length of this side also. So what you see is that these two lines would actually intersect at one point and this fixes the triangle. There is no other way I can move the triangle. There is no other way I can move these lines. And this is giving me only one triangle. So it is sufficient to prove congruency by fixing two angles and one side. Now what we need to check is, would any two angles and one side give me congruent triangles? Will that fix a triangle for me? Let's see. So here I had seen it fixes the triangle. So this fixes the triangle. What about this? Now I know fixing two angles, so here the side is between the angles. Here we have two angles and this side is outside these two angles. But we know that fixing two angles automatically fixes the third angle. So this angle is also fixed. So I can say again, this is the same as this because the side is enclosed between two fixed angles. So if I have two angles and one side that is fixed, then it guarantees that I would get a congruent triangle. No matter how you pick these two angles and one side. So they can be these two angles and this side. You can take any two angles and one side. So now let's try to name them. Since the order does not matter in which you pick these, since it does not matter which two angles you're picking and which is the side which you're picking, so you can name it as angle, side, angle, or you can say angle, angle, side. This again is same as angle, side, angle. So any of these two would do. You can say angle, side, angle, or angle, angle, side. Two angles, one side. Does not matter whether the side is included within the angles or is not. So if I have two triangles, say ABC and DEF, which has two angles same, 60 degrees, 60 degrees. So angle C is 60, angle F is 60 here. Angle B is 40 here, angle E is also 40. And there's one side which is the same. BC is same as EF, which is 6. So I can say that these two triangles are congruent by angle, side, angle, or you can also say angle, angle, side. Does not matter. Would you believe me if I tell you that this congruency result was used centuries ago? Let's see who used this and how it was used. Congruency was used in the 6th century BC by a great mathematician and philosopher named Thales, who lived in Greece. Let us see how he used congruency. This is a small trick he's supposed to have used to find the distance of an anchored ship from the shore. What he did was, he placed one stick directly in front of the ship. Then he moved some distance away and placed a second stick. The third stick was placed directly in middle of the first two sticks. Then he starts walking perpendicularly backward, keeping the ship in sight. He stops and marks this position when he just sees the middle stick in between the ship and himself in his line of sight. Further, he measured this distance, his distance from the second stick, and claimed that this distance was equal to the distance of the anchored ship from the shore. So was he correct? Of course he was. There was a trick he used. But how could he use this trick? How did he actually say that his distance was equal to the distance of the ship from the shore? Let us try to see. What we know is that he measured this distance, that is his distance from the stick, and said that it was equal to the distance of the anchored ship from the shore. So first, let's name these points. So I name this A, B, C, D, E. I name this diagram. Now what I know is that the stick C, this stick which is named C, was placed directly in the middle of the first two sticks. This third stick, which is C, was placed directly in middle of stick B and D. That we know. So what we know is that C is the midpoint of BD. We also know that he placed the first stick directly in front of the ship, so it is perpendicular. And he moved perpendicularly back from the second stick, which is stick D. So again, that is also perpendicular. So I know that angle B and angle D both are 90 degrees. So now, what I want to prove is that this distance, his distance from the stick, which is DE, is equal to BA, the distance of the ship from the shore. So this is what you want to prove, that AB is equal to ED. So we know that C is the midpoint, so BC would be equal to DC. BC would be equal to DC, and angle B and D both are 90 degrees. So these two things we already know. What is the third thing? We know that these two lines are intersecting at point C. So I call this angle 1 and angle 2. So angle 1 will be equal to angle 2 because they are vertically opposite angles. So I can say angle 1 is equal to 2, vertically opposite. Now, since I know BC is equal to CD, I know this angle is equal to this angle. I know that there's another angle which is equal in these two triangles. So by angle, side, angle, I can say that these two triangles are congruent. So I can say that ABC is congruent to triangle EDC by angle, side, angle. And now, once you know that triangles are congruent, we know that all the sides of two congruent triangles and all the corresponding angles of two congruent triangles are equal. So, ED and AB would be equal. So, this is what he said. He measured his distance from the stick and he said that this is equal to the distance of the anchored ship from the shore. This is what he said. So he said AB is equal to ED. So this is how angle side angle congruency was used centuries ago.